Shalom, everyone.
Shalom.
How are you?
Wonderful.
As I mentioned, it's a great honor and privilege to get to be with you and to share in the Torah and in serving Hashem together in this world. We just observed the festival of Shavuot just 2 weeks ago. Everybody knows that Shavuot is the time, it's the anniversary of receiving the Torah at Mount Sinai. And it's also the festival of the first fruits, Chag HaKatzir, the festival of the harvest. And the thing about Shavuot is that it's the anniversary of the Sinai Revelation, which is the most unbelievable event in human history, this rendezvous between God and man, the giving of the Torah, the Jewish people who received the Torah on behalf of humanity. I believe that all the souls of all the righteous of all the nations were also there. And the heavens opened and they perceived the reality of Hashem. And because of the way that we believe that the sacred seasons of Hashem, the calendar works, of course, we always say it's not about what it was then, it's about now. So it's about reliving. So we hope that we all observed Shavuot with the goal of receiving the Torah anew. We all received it again. And so now we are embracing it again. We entered into this covenant again. But the question is, when we talk about Torah, what is it exactly? What is it? You know, it's the manifestation of the Ratzon Hashem in this world. It's God's will. It is our moral code. It's our destiny. It's our purpose. It's our tikkun. It's got a lot of stories. It's got many, many levels of understanding. But what is it really? And in asking that question, I also have to ask, what does it mean to serve God? Everybody thinks the service of God means something else. And the tendency that a lot of people have is to mystify everything, which is not really the Jewish way. But this is the problem with the word religion, that some people, their whole thing is certain rituals and certain days, you know, when we take God out of a box and do him a big favor and do our gesticulation, then put him back and go and do other things. What does it really mean to be living attached to God all the time? What is the Torah really doing for us? And what does it really mean to serve him? I think these are very, very searing questions for our time. And so I was thinking, because of the blessing of the Torah cycle, right? Not only the calendar, how it works, but the readings of the Torah portions every week. And everybody who has the sweetness in their life of studying the weekly portion knows that there's something, it's just totally uncanny. This is about us. It's about now. It's about us. That's why we're doing it. That's why we're learning it, because it's mechuvan aleinu min hashamayim. That means that it's orchestrated, that we are learning something for us right now. Of course, there's a disparity right now between the land of Israel and the diaspora because of the second day of Shavuot that you observe in the diaspora, so we're off a little bit. But the point is, these days, we are studying something very particular. I was thinking to myself that in order to maybe understand this question that's so important, what is Torah really all about, and how do we serve Hashem, I was thinking that maybe there's a group of people that we could learn from that could teach us more than anyone else the answer to this question. And that's a group of people that we're learning about all the time now, that we're very, very involved with, very occupied with, and that's the generation of the desert, generation of the wilderness. They're also called by our sages of blessed memory the generation of knowledge, Dor HaDe'ah, which also implies a certain degree of self-knowledge, which is very difficult. They're also referred to as the generation that ate the manna, and that's not for no reason that they're described as such. But the point is, all during these weeks in the Book of Numbers, we're reading about this amazing generation that can only be described really in one word. If you had to sum it all up in one word, who these people are, I gave this a lot of thought. The word would have to be inscrutable. Inscrutable means difficult to comprehend. And I say that because this generation, they were so amazing. They lived with God under the most intimate of circumstances. They ate from his table. They ate the manna upon which they made the blessing. Hamotzi lechem min hashamayim. who brings forth bread from heaven, right? They, as the Torah testifies, their feet never swelled up even though they were walking in the desert for 40 years. Their clothing was perfect because the clouds of glory pressed and cleaned their clothing. They lived like almost with an umbilical cord of attachment to God. And yet, as we will read in this week's Torah portion, Parashat Shelach, they were a dismal failure because they spoke against the land of Israel, which was too much for God, and he decreed what he decreed against them. They didn't go in. So when we read about this generation, the overwhelming feeling that we get is one of, I can't understand them, because on the one hand, they were so high, and make no mistake, they were actually very, very holy. And the sages are very lavish in their praise of these people. They say there was never such a pious and righteous generation in history, that when they died, there was no worm or vermin that attacked their bodies. They were so pure. There'll never be another generation like this until Mashiach comes. These are all quotations in Chazal, Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer. There are all sorts of ancient works that talk about how great they were. And we can see point by point how great they were. But at the same time, they also tested God 10 times, right? As he says in this week's Torah portion, Parashat Shelach, this generation that tested me these 10 times in the desert, and finally, that's it, they're not going in. So how do we understand these people that frankly were so conflicted? What is that, bipolar, is it? I mean, they were so great that they heard God's voice at Mount Sinai, the heavens opened up and they perceived the reality of Hashem, whatever that means. They saw the thunder, right, as it says in Parashat Yitro. They were absolutely, they left Egypt, they saw the 10 plagues, the splitting of the sea. All the verses that Moshe tells us about how that was the beginning of all knowledge and everything that happened there, and their most impeccable relationship with God throughout the years of the desert. Coming to this week's Torah portion, where they had this nuclear failing, meltdown, breakdown, freak out that no one understands, and we'll talk about that. So my question to myself is, really, when you're honest and you read about how great they were, and again, I'm not making anything up, they were absolutely testified to be so great. So my question when I come to this every year and I'm studying the book of Numbers is, how could it be that a generation that was so conflicted is the generation that received the Torah? And to ask it in a way that's a little bit more, ouch, did the Torah not work for them? Did they not do the tikkun? Like, how come if they received the Torah, they were the generation of knowledge, something happened, whatever happened, and it was a total fizzle out? So these are some of the questions that I want to consider, and in so doing, try to understand maybe the very nature of Torah and what it does for us and how we serve Hashem together. So getting back to that generation is just so amazing. I'm telling you, there's nothing like it. When you start to go deeply into the words of our sages about how they were so blessed, but again, all the while, the same time, is actually in the tractate Sanhedrin, in the parak called, in the chapter called Chelek, there's actually a discussion amongst the sages that were so divided about their nature because of everything that I'm saying, that I'm feeling so totally confused about who they were, that the sages actually have a discussion amongst themselves. Do they or do they not have a portion in the world to come? Ad kedei kach, which means to that extent, the sages were so disturbed about trying to understand the generation of the desert that none other, first I'll cut to the chase, the bottom line, the consensus of opinion, the psak, as it were, in that section is, yes, they certainly do. And not only that, but they're the first that will come back in the resurrection. but none other than our precious Rabbi Akiva. He's of the opinion, no, they don't have a portion in the world to come, which is a bizarre thing, because Rabbi Akiva, as everybody knows, who was like the embodiment of the oral tradition, his entire life's work was one of total compassion. Even his legislation, everything about him is so deeply caring that the other sages said, like, what happened to you? Like, that's not your type of thing to say. That how could you say such a thing? They don't have a share in the world to come. Great mystery that we're going to explore now. One of the mysteries regarding all of this. But anyway, they do come in, and in fact, there's a whole idea, you know, that Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, he actually, see, there's two different generations in the book of Numbers. This is very important. There's the generation of the desert and the generation that came in. And the switch is about chapter 18 or so, around Parshat Chukat. And the old guard is finished, and then the new generation, they couldn't wait to come in. But they're so two totally separate generations, and Moshe, on the soul level, he was attached very much to the generation of the desert, and he didn't maybe understand the next generation. And Joshua, of course, he's the one who brought the new generation in. And by the way, you know that when the generation of the Eretz Israel, the generation that came in with Joshua, there was something very unusual about that generation. You know what it was? That because the decree that we're going to be reading about this week in Parshat Shelach, of the Lashon Hara, you know, of that generation that passed away in the desert, was on all the men that received the Lashon Hara and believed it over the age of 20. But women were not included in that decree. And as we all know, ladies, women are much more spiritual than the men. Men? Sorry, we just have to admit it. But women have more of a spiritual fine-tune awareness. They are much more attached to who they are supposed to be and their purpose, and their ego is much more in check. So that when it came, for example, to the sin of the golden calf, the women did not participate in that sin. You know that, Aaron. And again, that's not exactly as it appears. It wasn't like this rank, foul idolatry. It was about the fact that Moshe was 6 hours late and Aaron was very nervous. He was trying to push them off. And the Arab got this idea, and they were looking for some sort of intermediary in the meantime to focus on, which of course is totally forbidden. And so Aaron says to the men, get your women's earrings, thinking that it's gonna really postpone it because the women are not going to want to give up their earrings. And he was right, but not because they didn't want to give up their jewelry, but because they wanted no part of the golden calf. But then in the very next verse, it says the men all took off their earrings. And I don't want to go there, what that means about style or anything like that. We have enough problems. But the point is, so the women did not participate in the sin of the golden calf, and so too, the women did not participate in the sin of the evil speech against the land of Israel. They did not accept it. They did not listen. They did not believe it. And the generation that came in with Joshua consisted of the new generation and a lot of grandmothers, a lot of old women. That's who came into the land of Israel. But Moshe, he wanted to come in so badly, not to eat the fruits and not to go to the Dan Panorama or something like that, but to do the mitzvot of the land of Israel. And because the land of Israel is the honor of Hashem. But according to the Midrash, Hashem said to Moshe, how would it look if you came in with the new generation and not the ones that you let out? Everybody's going to say, you must kill them yourself. And Hashem said, according to the Midrash to Moshe, it's like, he said the parable, it's like a shepherd takes the king's flock out and they're all killed. And then he wants to come back, but they say to him, but they're going to say you killed them. So Hashem says to Moshe, you know what? You stay here with them and you come in with them in the future. So he's going to come in with that generation. But in the meantime, we have that strange opinion of Rabbi Akiva that they have no share in the world to come, which is not the way the rest of the majority of the sages speak about it. And all through the way, in the book of Numbers, we're looking at this topsy-turvy cycle of up and down all the time. And we should just take one example, right? I said another appellation of that generation, another way that they're known is the generation Ochle Haman, the generation that ate the manna. This isn't just a description, or it's not just a historical thing, you know, they ate the manna. Eating the manna, we've spoken about this before, it was an incredibly searing, wrenching experience to eat the manna. You had to be very real, and you had to have a very high level of integrity, because everything about the manna was a proof of your personality. Like it was like an X-ray that showed exactly who you are. In fact, the sages say something very, very powerful. They say the manna played the same role in the life of Israel as did a prophet. This is the quotation. They say, just as a prophet shined the light into the deepest crevices, nooks and crannies and cracks of a person, that's what the manna did also. What does that mean? Everything about the manna showed who a person is. Just on the simplest level, we know that it fell for everybody. But according to your level of righteousness, that's how hard you had to work for it. So you know, do you still have your milk delivered to the doorstep in some places in America? No, nobody does that anymore? Am I showing my age? Okay. So what happened is, like, for a person that was very, very righteous, they would just get up in the morning, put on their robe, stretch, come out the front door, just like you have your bottle of milk on your paper, and there it was. For people that maybe were like had a little work to do on themselves, they had to go and find it. And for people that were really not so good, they had to really search for it. So we saw already who's who. There was no hiding it. And of course, everybody knows that the manna would taste exactly like anything that you wanted. So you wanted a corn dog, not catfish, but, you know, grits, whatever. OU something, OU, maybe OUD at the most, but the point is. And then, of course, all the secrets of livelihood we understand from the portion of the manna, how, you know, Hashem is taking care of us, He's feeding us, thank you so much, He's feeding us in our mouths. And why is it called manna? Who remembers why it's called manna? As it says, they said to each other, manhu, ki lo yadu mahu. They said to each other, what is it? Because they didn't know what it was. So He's feeding them in their mouth, and they're like, I don't know, you know what it is? I don't know what it is. God is taking care of us, we don't recognize it. And of course, if you take too much, what happened is that it rotted away. So that's the hoarder mentality, that we have to have everything because we just have to have it. But one of the most interesting things about it, because there's nothing that the sages tell us that's anecdotal. Everything is powerful and means something powerful on so many levels. The metaphor of Chazal is so powerful on a psychological level alone. So there's a midrash that tells us, it's commenting on the fact that, as everybody knows, 39 years, Israel wandering through the desert, they never had to relieve themselves. Because the manna had no physical byproduct. It wasn't physical. It was pure will of Hashem. And so everybody knows when you eat the part that is nutritious, you know, gives you strength, and the rest has to be expunged. They didn't have anything at all because it was all pure. But this is what the Midrash says. And again, there's nothing anecdotal here. So the Midrash tells us, I call it a psychodrama, the way that our sages of blessed memory teach us the deepest lessons. So this is what they say. They say two people talking to each other, Reuven and Shimon. And one says to the other, like, privately, like, tell me something. Have you gone lately to the bathroom? He says, I haven't, did you? And they said to each other, you know what? We're going to explode. Listen. Because it's not possible for a person to take in and not put out. What they really mean is what they were really complaining about was, I'm going to explode from the Hashem inside of me. Because I have to be so real. And this is such a responsibility that I'm going to explode. I can't handle the pressure of what it means to to really be committed. That's what they mean. This is not, they're not joking around with us. They're not wasting our time with the sophomoric humor. I'm going to explode from the Hashem inside of me. So, in this past week's Torah portion, for example, Parshat Bahalotcha, that we read about, I can't imagine a better example of a parsha that shows us everything that I'm trying to say, the dichotomy of the split person of this generation in one Torah portion. The parsha in chapter 8 of the book of Numbers begins with the iconography of the menorah, the command to Aaron to have the flames come up straight, all of us bringing the light of Hashem into the world. And we have the whole idea of the wandering of the camp and this and the signal of the cloud of glory getting ready to move and the ark that went out before and the trumpets blasting. This is a nation. This is a portrait of a nation that's living with Hashem in its midst and that's very, very much aware of that and exemplifying this. And then, of course, in this parsha that we just read, Bahalotcha, we have the most amazing novel idea, maybe one of them, in the whole Torah, which is Second Passover. Second Passover, an unsung holiday for which Hallmark never made a card. And that's ridiculous. It's one of the most important days to wish someone a happy Second Passover. How come they never caught on that the Jewish market and the Noahid market would be big if we would have a Second Passover card? You know why? Because we like to call the Second Passover the holiday of second chances. Because we have an idea which is has no parallel in the whole Torah. Group of people are contaminated through no fault of their own, come to Moshe and they say, we didn't get to bring the Passover offering on time, can we still bring it? What kind of an idea is that? There's nowhere in the Torah that you have such an idea. In fact, one of the things that invalidates an offering is if it's too late. But instead of Moshe saying, that's the most ridiculous thing I ever heard, you know, how dare you, he says, well, I'll go ask Hashem. So he goes to Hashem, and Hashem says, yeah, exactly. This is what they should do exactly 1 month later, on the 14th of Iyar. And so there's a huge lesson here that is endless. That very day, the sages teach us, is the day that we read about in Parshat Bishalach in Exodus 17, that Amalek came to attack Israel, because on a spiritual level, Amalek, the sworn enemy of the Jewish people, their whole thing is to convince you that you have no second chance, to fill you with despair and hopelessness on a spiritual level. So the second Passover is like, you always have a second chance. Of course, the reason that it's about the Passover is because of that importance of that ideal for the Jewish people. The Passover is the entire national identity of the nation is dependent on the commandment that we slaughter the idolatry of the world before their very eyes. That's what the Passover offering is all about. But the beautiful thing about the second Passover is that, like everything else in Torah, we initiate and Hashem responds. Like the verse David says in Psalms, Hashem is your shadow. The verse Psalm says, Hashem tzilcha al yad yiminecha. Hashem is your shadow by your right hand. Hashem is your shadow? Your shadow does what you do. Exactly. Because ani l'dodi v'dodi li, right? Elul. I am to my beloved and my beloved is to me. But the verse starts not with my beloved is to me. I am to my, as I will be to my beloved, he will be to me. You get what you do. A equals A. So the most beautiful thing about the second Passover that generation understood was that Hashem gives us a second chance. And it was from the 6 days of creation, he was waiting for us to ask for it. So yeah, he'll give you the second chance, but even the second chance has to be your idea. And then Hashem says, wow, what a great idea. Yes, I was waiting to give that to you. I just wanted you to ask for a second chance. So it's just perfectly placed in Parshat Bahalotcha. It's so magnificent. And then all of a sudden, in chapter 11, the people took to seeking complaints. I have to tell you this without wanting to sound anti-Semitic. You're a tough audience. That was a little light. They're very obnoxious sounding. They're starting to complain now. Hashem is feeding them manna, and they're like, our life is parched. There's nothing. We have nothing to anticipate about the manna. Oh, another night of manna. Another night of Hashem giving us his raw essence. Oh, gosh, I wish I had a turkey schnitzel. I don't know. I wish I had a TV dinner. Another night of manna? Does this pick up? We remember the fish we ate in Egypt for free. Man, we were living the life of Riley. Cucumbers, melons, leeks, onions, and garlic. That was so great. So first of all, it's just so chilling. This is a false memory. You know what a false memory is? This never happened. They didn't get anything in Egypt for free. They took their babies and ground them into mortar, the Egyptians did, and made them use that mortar for the bricks. So do you think they gave them free fish? So as our sages tell us, this is an illusion. Remember what we ate in Egypt, free of charge. This goes hand in hand with that midrash about how we were going to explode. Free of charge, we remember when we were free of obligation, when we had no responsibility. But even this is not exactly as it appears to be. This started with the Erev Rav, the rabble that was among them, cultivated a craving, and the children of Israel also wept once more. But the thing is, the Hebrew here is so amazing. I just read it in English. The rabble that was among them cultivated a craving. It avu tahava means that they had a craving to have a craving. That's exactly what it means, meaning that they thought, this is not normal. We're not like other people. We want to be like other people. It's too much, this godly life, as it were. So they cultivated a craving. Anyway, we go on and on. Moshe, he says, and I can really identify with this on a communal level sometimes, he says to God, I alone cannot carry this entire nation, for it's too heavy for me. And if this is how you deal with me, then kill me now if I found favor in your eyes. If you like me, kill me. I can't put up with them anymore. All this just to say, look how just so totally at this diametric opposites this generation would behave with such greatness and at the same time such total disarray. How could it be? How could it be? So then finally, again, there are so many more examples of the beauty of this generation, how high they were, everything that they went through and their commitments, but they're yet so conflicted. And my question that I began with, I can't understand my whole life as I'm studying this, why did they deserve to receive the Torah? To the extent that the sages use all of this in their perfect expression and their golden way of speaking to say, the Torah was only given to the generation that ate the manna. The Torah was only given to the generation of knowledge. I don't understand how people could be so totally at opposite ends with itself. So this week we come to the horrific disaster that we still suffer from to this day, Parshat Shelach, the sin of the spies. The command to send spies to Eretz Yisrael, Hashem said to Moshe, saying, send forth men, if you please, and let them spy out the land of Canaan that I give to the children of Israel. The art scroll over here has the little synopsis on the side, and it's inaccurate, because it says, the command to send spies to Eretz Yisrael. It wasn't a command. It was permission. It was actually, as Moshe tells us later, it was your idea, it was the people's idea, and Hashem said, you know what, you want to do it, do it. Moshe was not the playing the role here of the commander-in-chief of the armed forces and sending in reconnaissance to see how things have to be done. That's not it at all. When he said, see in which land it dwells. Is it strong? Is it weak? The people that dwells there, is it good or bad? Do they have trees there? All these things our sages teach us are a code for the spiritual dimension of those people there and the spiritual dimension of what was going to be going on there so that they would be prepared. This wasn't about any sort of military maneuver. And Hashem said, if they're bothering you to send them, you want to send them, send them. Vakasha, send them. Actually, I had a very interesting idea this week about this. This expression, shalach lecha, send for yourself. I realized the connection between those words and something that we're all familiar with, very, very important, the opening words to Genesis chapter 12, lech lecha. When Hashem said to Avram, at that time Avram, before Avraham, everybody knows he said to him, go for yourself from your land and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land that I will show you, right? And so everybody knows the famous statement, lech lecha, go for yourself. And of course on the simple level that, because I can't bless you here, so go, it's really for you, because when you'll go, I'll be able to improve your situation, bless you, etc., etc. So go for yourself. It's really for you. But on a deeper level, the sages teach us that lech lecha literally means, and this is the Hebrew, means lech lecha, go into yourself. Go not just for yourself, but into yourself. In other words, it's a spiritual journey of self-knowledge. Discover yourself. Go into yourself. And that is quite well known and quite accepted regarding lech lecha. And so all of a sudden I realized, shlach lecha is the same thing. You know what? You need something here. You're feeling vulnerable. You have issues. You have problems. Go for yourself and see what it is that you need exactly. It has nothing to do with me, Hashem is saying. So they go, and they were all distinguished men. Kulam anashim. They were all distinguished men. And as Rashi cites, again from the Talmud, they were all ksherim. At that time, they were all righteous men. This was not a gang of, I was going to say a gang of bikers, but we have a biker protecting us this evening. And I'm a biker myself. So I'm saying this was not a gang of whatever it is you want to say. These were the princes of the tribes of Israel. They were all holy, righteous men, which adds to our exasperation and exacerbates the situation. What happened to them? Because when they went in, they were all perfect tzaddikim. But something happened and they snapped, right? They snapped. They had some sort of incredible disconnect. And I don't know if we'll ever exactly answer what happened to them because there are so many different opinions about it. Some say more positive about it, and some say more negative. I'll give you some examples. But the point is, something happened, and they changed, and they came back, and they caused the nation to cry for no reason. They said, we cannot ascend to that people, for it is too strong for us. And they brought the fruit, and they said, yeah, we were there. It's beautiful. All the people that we saw in it were huge. There we saw the Nephilim, the sons of the giant from among the Nephilim. We were like grasshoppers in our eyes, and so were we in their eyes. And as our sages tell us, there was a lot going on there that God, in his infinite mercy, was actually making a lot of distractions so that the locals would not pay attention to them. He's doing a lot of things that were involved in a lot of funerals. And so they saw people were having funerals, and they came back and said, it's a land that devours its inhabitants. They misread all of the signals that Hashem was providing for them, thinking that actually it's very dangerous, but really Hashem was helping them. They come back and they say, we can't go ki chazaku mimenu. They're stronger than us. But again, when you study in Hebrew, then you know that things are not as they appear in the English. One of the unusual things about this word in Hebrew, mimenu, they're stronger than us, is that it also bears the connotation directly of they're stronger than him. So they're really saying is that this is too much for God. He can't handle this. They're too strong for him. So they come back, and everybody knows, what night was that? The ninth of Av. That was the first of the tragic cycle of the ninth of Av. They actually left but I think today is the 23rd or the 24th of Sivan. They left on the 26th of Sivan. They were involved in their walk the entire month of Tammuz, and they came back the 40th day, the eve of the 9th of Av. And the people were broken from their news, except for Yehoshua and Kalev, who adamantly opposed them. They succeeded in bringing the people to the level of total hysteria. Let's appoint a leader, go back to Egypt. And then the decree was made. The decree was made against that generation. Those that participated in that sin, the spies themselves, were punished directly from Hashem. And the rest, it was decreed that they would die in the desert. And here again, it's an unbelievably powerful idea that our sages teach us about the death that was decreed on that generation. People didn't die, let's say, on February 24th or in the middle of June. Every year on Tisha B'Av, 18,000 people died, only on Tisha B'Av, throughout the 39 years that were remaining. So this, what happened was, it's just horrific to read about. The whole camp of Israel, on the eve of Tisha B'Av, all the men dug graves, said goodbye to their families, and they went to sleep in the grave. In the morning, Moses went through the camp and announced, "Let the living separate from the dead." And those who made it through the night rose up, and the rest, that was their end on Tisha B'Av. Until finally, in the end, one of the reasons for the holiday of the 15th of Av was because that year, when the moon was full on the 15th, and they realized they didn't make a mistake with the calculation, they knew that the decree was finished because no one died on that last year. So this was the situation with the 9th of Av, and again, both temples were destroyed on that day. The Spanish expulsion in 1492 was done that day. World War I began on that day. The Treblinka gas chambers began operation on the 9th of Av. Not that God is Al Capone and is like saying, like, "Oh, I'm gonna," or like, you know, Edward G. Robinson, "Oh, you're gonna cry for no reason, huh? I'll always give you a reason to cry." That's not how it works. But there are patterns in time that we create. So Hashem is not gunning for us, but we are responsible for what we create. And so when there is retribution, because there is a price to pay for everything, of reciprocity, that's the time. And this is very, very hard to understand what happened to them exactly. And there are some that look at it that, well, they're arguing who's going to be the chief rabbi when they come in. You know, they look at it in a more kind of petty way. And there are some that look at it in a completely different way. I'm greatly summarizing here and skimming this topic. There are some that look at it, basically the idea is they made a terrible mistake. And the mistake was in thinking that the life that they were living in the deserts was as good as it gets and preferable to going into the land. Everybody knows that when they went into the land, the manna stopped on that very day, right? We read in Joshua, they had to plant, they had to sow. It was a whole different lifestyle. And they looked at the way that they were living in the desert, and they saw who they were, that they were so attached to God. They were like living in an incubator. It doesn't get higher than this, they thought. How could we descend to a life of regular when we are so close to God? And of course, the mistake that they made is in everything, because actually, here, I'll cut to the chase. Spin it this way. I was looking at it wrong. It's not that, the question isn't, how is it that the Torah was given to such a conflicted generation? The Torah was given to them because they were so conflicted. And that's the beauty of being a human being. That's the real Torah. It's of this earth. You know, What happened? We're talking about the giving of the Torah, the revelation at Mount Sinai. And there in Parshat Yitro, and also later when Moshe reviews it in Deuteronomy, we read what happened. The entire people saw the thunder and the flames, the sound of the shofar and the smoking mountain. They stood and trembled and stood from afar. They said to Moshe, "You speak to us, we shall hear. God not speak to us, we shouldn't die." And Hashem said, "So shall you say to the children of Israel, you have seen that I have spoken to you from heaven, so don't make any images." And then we have here, this is, I think, one of the most beautiful ideas. We have what I like to refer to as the 11th commandments, right after the 10 commandments. "An altar of earth shall you make for me, and you shall slaughter near it your burnt offerings," etc. "And when you make for me an altar of stones, do not build them hewn." I'm coming from the Sinai revelation. The heavens opened up. We perceive the reality of Hashem, whatever that means. And so you could easily think, how do I serve such a God? How do you follow that act? He has no beginning and no end. Who are we? Who are we to serve such a God? It's hopeless. Hashem says, "No, I love this world. You're not. I don't expect you to be something that you're not. See this earth and stones and dirt? That's what you do for me. Don't worry about it not being so Hollywood or whatever I'm trying to say here about what you saw there, what you didn't see. No, this is it. This is what I love. Build me an altar of earth and stones. That's where I want to be in this world." It's like the famous Midrash that everybody knows. Moshe goes out to receive the Torah and the angels want to kick him out from the heavenly sphere that he came into, and he's frightened, and they're pushing him, and he says to Hashem, "What do I do?" And Hashem says, "Answer them." Because they're saying, "What's flesh and blood doing here? You're going to give the Torah to the earth?" And Moshe says to the angels, "It says in the Torah, honor your father and mother." "Do you have a father and a mother?" "It says in the Torah, don't plow with two different animals. Do you have a farm?" And Hashem says, "You answered very well. The Torah is very real." So on this level, the mistake that they made was such a core mistake. They were supposed to go into the land of Israel to fix Adam HaRishon, what he did, and to start to bring light into the world. And they're looking at it like they were so holy and they were so close to Hashem, but that's not the real closeness to Hashem. Can you imagine what we're saying here? It's such an unbelievable thing. They were closer to Hashem than we can possibly imagine life to be, but that's not it. So you can go into like a tower and you can meditate on your navel, or you can go om, or you can, I don't know, do all kinds of things, and you can call it being religious and having a religious experience. But the Torah considers it to be a religious experience for a man to have to deal with his mother-in-law and to do business ethically and all the things that we have to do. That's what it means to serve Hashem in this world. It doesn't count to just be, "I'm so holy today." And that was the mistake that they made. You know what a beautiful proof of this is? Beautiful proof of this is that we just, like I said, we just observe Shavuot, right? How do we observe Shavuot today? It's a very beautiful custom. We stay up the whole night studying the Torah. And in the morning, we go to the morning service at the crack of dawn. It's a very exhilarating experience. But that custom is not that old by our standards. It's like 1,500 years old. In the time of the Holy Temple, that's not how Shavuot was observed. This is strange. Because Shavuot is the festival that commemorates the giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai, which is a total ethereal spiritual experience, a rendezvous between man and God. And how is Shavuot observed in the Holy Temple? By bringing the first fruits to the Holy Temple in a basket and waving it in front of the Kohen. What does that have to do with the giving of the Torah? If I go to the standard yeshiva today, and I tell yeshiva boy that's sitting and studying the Talmud all day, you know how Shavuot was observed in the Holy Temple, don't forget, not by studying Torah the whole night, by bringing your first fruits, you'd say, what does it have to do with what I'm reading here in the Talmud? What does it have to do with it? The real Torah is of this world. It's so profound. That was the beauty and the honor of Shavuot, to bring the fruits to Hashem and to thank Him and acknowledge that everything is only from Him. I keep saying this is one of the most beautiful ideas that I've ever seen in Deuteronomy and Parshat Kitavo, when we read about the pilgrim who comes to the Beit HaMikdash, or the Holy Temple, with the first fruits, and he reads the whole confession, which is like a microcosm of our history, and he comes to the Kohen with this basket. And in general, I mean, the whole idea of the first fruits from the Mishnah, you know, is so powerful, because a man, this is what the Mishnah says, a man goes into his field, he sees a pomegranate or a grape or a date ripening, and he ties a band around that very fruit, and he declares orally, this is first fruits. And instead of devouring it on the spot, because he worked so hard to get to this moment, it's not about me. He closes the circle, he brings it up to the Holy Temple, and he declares before Hashem, this is only from you. I have nothing in this world. You gave it to me. And he puts it in a basket. And the word that's used here by the Torah for basket is a very specific word, tene, which is three letters. It's tet nun aleph, tene. And there's a teaching from the Holy Baal Shem Tov on this verse. He just says one simple sentence and he doesn't explain it. It took me my whole life to understand what he's saying. Very cryptic. The Holy Baal Shem Tov says, tene, which spells basket, is an acronym. It stands for three words. Ta'amim, nukudot, otiyot. Tet nun aleph, which means the cantillation marks of how we read the song of the words in the Torah, the letters and the vowels. In other words, the three components that make up a word. He says that's what the basket is. And what he means is actually very obvious. The basket that the pilgrim brings the fruit in is made up of his words. The acknowledgement, the thankfulness, the recognition of Hashem in our lives. That's the main part of the service here, is to recognize Hashem in our lives. So that's really the real Torah. And on the one level, we see that they apparently didn't understand that according to this interpretation. They really totally missed it in thinking that the life that they lived in the desert, that sheltered, beautiful, holy life, was what Hashem intended. And they were thinking that we're not going to have that anymore when we come into the land of Israel. We're going to have to be regular people. But that's exactly it. And that was the mistake on that level. And so as we read Parshat Shelach, with all its devastation of what happened to them, all of a sudden, after the decree, we have in the beginning of chapter 15 something new. We have a tiding of two commandments that were not applicable to that generation, the generation that was to perish in the desert. Hashem told Moshe, tell the children of Israel about these two commandments when you will come into the land, because they will come into the land eventually. I'm giving them two commandments to do. The libations, which are the wine that's poured out on the altar to accompany every offering, and the mitzvah, the commandment of challah, which is to separate a certain amount of dough and give it as a present to the Levite. Those two commandments are totally bound up with the identity of Eretz Israel, of the land of Israel. So on the one hand, Hashem is telling them a beautiful thing. Don't worry, you will go in. But there's a much deeper thing even here that he's telling them. What do we do Friday nights? Every Friday night, we do kiddush over the wine, and we do hamotzi over the challah. Why? Why those two things? So according to a deep understanding of our sages of blessed memory, the tree of knowledge in the Garden of Eden was either wheat or grapes. True, when I was waiting in the dentist's office in 1963, as a little boy looking at the illustrated Bible stories, it was always pictured as a shiny red apple. with Adam with his loincloth and his six-pack and everything like that. But the truth is, according to our sages, it was either wheat or grapes. And so on Shabbat, when we sanctify Hashem and testify that He created the world and continues to create it, we do the tikkun for Adam HaRishon. And that's what the people of Israel are supposed to be doing when they come into the land. Everything that they do is supposed to be about the tikkun, the rectification of Adam HaRishon. That's why He gave them now the libations on the challah to signal that once again. But the long and the short of it is that whatever it is that happened to them, which is so hard for us to understand, essentially because they were... It would seem to us on a simple level that this is much less severe than the sin of the golden calf, which, by the way, the verse tells us regarding the sin of the golden calf, about 3,000 people died in a plague, and then it was business as usual. It's like, it's not even important enough to tell me exactly how many people died. Ki, shloshet alafim, about 3,000 people died, and then they were going to come into the land of Israel. But when it came to speaking against the land, that's when Hashem said, this is not going to continue. So you don't have to be an ultra ardent, patriotic Zionist like me to tell you that apparently, because I'm not making it up because it's right here, I'm not spinning it. They tested Hashem 10 times, two by the water, two on account of two on account of water, two on account of the manna, two on account of the quails, the sin of the golden calf. I'm missing something, but I have it written down here, but I'm getting tired. This was the sin that ended it all, speaking against the land of Israel. Why is that? First of all, we know that the sin of Lashon Hara, of ill speech against a person, the sages say it's better for a person to throw themselves into a fiery furnace than to speak ill of another person. And Lashon Hara isn't a lie. It could even be true. But if it's damaging to another person, then you're not allowed to say something publicly. So first of all, there's a very deep lesson that we are taught by the Holy Ramchal, which is very chastising and very chilling. It teaches us a lot about Torah as well. He says... like this. He's trying to explain to us the power of Lashon Hara, of evil speech. He says, when a person leaves this world and they come before judgment, there's an accuser there. And so first, the good deeds of the person are read, and then the accuser comes with a whole stack of portfolios about the person, and he's about to speak. But if that person never spoke Lashon Hara about another person, then Hashem turns to the accuser and he says, not interested. And the accuser is like, I have so much to say, but Hashem says, no. But if the person was a great person and did all kinds of wonderful good deeds, but spoke Lashon Hara, then Hashem says, okay, your turn. Why? Because of this profound idea of reciprocity, that it's not like people think that if you do A, you get B, but rather, if you do A, you get A. So if you spoke, then he'll speak about you. But if you didn't speak, Hashem doesn't allow him to speak. That just tells us something about the nature of this damage that people think, what difference does it make? It's not action, it's just speech. But here, the situation is more complex and stranger. Because when they offended Hashem himself in the sin of the golden calf, it was serious, and Moshe had to intervene, but they were forgiven. But they were not forgiven for speaking against the land of Israel. Why? Why is that? And the reason, again, not because we're trying to interpolate a Zionistic outlook on the Torah portion, but because of the truth. Hashem was willing to forego his own honor, but not the honor of the land of Israel, because the land of Israel is the footstool. It is the representation of Hashem's honor in this world. And that's why the sages teach that this is one of the sins which is so severe that there is a concentric circles repercussion and reverberation in every generation. And that's why today there is such total disproportionate attempt to besmirch, delegitimize, isolate the land of Israel more and more all the time. We caused this. The sin of the spy caused this. And that's why this is actually the time of the tikkun of the sin of the spies. And that's why the most important thing that all of us can do, especially during this season, is to not accept the Lashon Hara against the land of Israel, and more so to be an advocate, to stand up for everything that the land of Israel represents, because this is exactly what we're reading about. This is exactly what the sin of the spies is about. But I think the amazing thing here that we are learning when it comes to this amazing generation is how it's so easy for a person to make this mistake. It's such a fine line to think that the Torah expects something from us that we are not capable of giving, and not to appreciate what the Torah really does expect from us, which is to be exactly who we are, real people. It's so amazing to think that the mistake that they made was in thinking that the life that they led in the desert, which was so idyllic and so holy, they thought that that was as close to Hashem as they could be, whereas what we're learning is that what they might have considered as a step down, as a downgrade from first class to coach, actually was what Hashem intended it to be, because it's more real. It's the real thing. So getting back to the beautiful, precious Rabbi Akiva, what we're taught about his opinion is this. He didn't actually deviate from his traditional compassion. But you see, the whole idea of Olam Haba is that in the future rectified world, every person is able to achieve and to grasp what was beyond them in this world, and every person is able to complete what they were missing. And basically Rabbi Akiva's opinion about that generation was that they were already there. That's why he says they have no portion in the world to come, because they were as high as could possibly be, and there was no tikkun for them. So he's actually telling us something very, very high. But the beauty of all of this, again, when we think about the Bikurim, the first fruits, what it means to really be alive for Hashem in this world. Everybody knows that when we counted the days of the Omer, from Pesach to Shavuot, right, those 49 days, we were ascending levels of consciousness and divesting ourselves of the slave mentality that we had in Egypt so that we could stand free and erect as human beings on the eve of Shavuot to receive the Torah. And that the offering on the day after the first day of Pesach is the raw barley, which is animal food because it's this constricted slave consciousness. But then when they came to Mount Sinai, Shavuot, we have the offering of the twin loaves of wheat, which is the only time that chametz, that leaven, is ever allowed to be brought in the Holy Temple, because there's no danger of a haughty heart because we receive the Torah, and that tempers us. But there's a very interesting parallel between the counting of the 49 days from Passover to Shavuot and the evolution of our consciousness to another cycle. Because what happened is that on the night of Passover, when we left Egypt, we left at this full throttle acceleration, and we were taken out at exactly the right moment with a tremendous blinding light of compassion. But the next day it was gone. And we had to work for it slowly, slowly, one level at a time. Because if you don't work for something, it's not a real soul-level acquisition. It doesn't count. You have to make it real. That's the macro on a national level of the micro that we learn about. That's so breathtaking. The Talmud says that every unborn child in the mother's womb learns the whole Torah before birth, right? And when you're born, you're caused to forget it. I have it on good authority that this isn't only talking about the Jewish people, it's talking about everyone who lives for Hashem. Every human being, I think, actually is on this level of knowledge before birth. And the Talmud says that the unborn child in the mother's womb has a candle at its head, and by that light it sees from one end of the world to the other. And it's referring to the fact that before we are born, we're on a level of Adam HaRishon before he ate from the tree. It's pure. And then when you're born, you forget everything. And the question is, if you're going to forget everything, why did you have to learn in the first place? And the answer is that everything that we do in this world is a type of deja vu, that we have a head start. Just like when we left on Passover, we got out with that unbelievable light, but then it was gone the next day. We had to count and build on it and work on our spiritual development. So too, there's something inside of us. It's intuitive. We have it there, but we have to activate it. It's very personal. There's a very beautiful thing about that teaching that's even deeper, which is that every person learns everything, the whole Torah, all the secrets of the universe, is very close to Hashem. But we don't all learn the same one. Or let me put it to you this way, and this is a very deep teaching that our sages tell us. We all learn the whole Torah, but everybody has a different path and learns it according to what they have to do in this world. Because no two people have the same thing to contribute to the world. Everybody has their own particular aspect of the world's orchestrated, beautiful rectification that only we can do. That's why there are billions of people in the world. Hashem needs all of them. I'll give you a beautiful example, also, of course, from our gorgeous, breathtaking book of Numbers, which it contains the sum total of human existence and experience and potential. In Parshat Naso, we learned about the offerings of the tribes, of the princes, at the dedication of the tabernacle. And Parshat Naso, we have in chapter 7 the offerings, and every single leader brought the same thing exactly. It's hundreds of verses, right? Okay, sorry, it's not hundreds. It's 84. No, it's 88. But every single one brought the same thing. The one who brought his offering on the first day was Nachshon, son of Aminadab, the tribe of Judah. His offering was 1 silver bowl, its weight 130 shekels, and 1 silver basin of 70 shekels. If you study Torah, you know the first thing, the first rule is that the Torah is very economical with words. Not one letter is wasted. Why not just say, this was the offering of each one of the 12 princes? Why spend all this repeating it? So aside from the fact that there are huge and deep mysteries on the deeper levels that are revealed here to people who know those things, not simple Jews like me, but on a simple level, I know something else. I know that just because each person brought the same thing doesn't mean that they had the same thing in mind. And it doesn't mean that their motivation was the same. It doesn't mean that they felt the same way. So every single one of these contributions that looks maybe ostensibly that it was the same thing was completely different, because that's the beauty of the personal side of each one of us. Every one of us, it looks like we're all serving God doing the same thing, but it's not true. Everyone is precious. Everyone is doing something else. And that's one of the things that we learn there. And so we have this unbelievable teaching that is one of the greatest mysteries in the Torah. To make a long story short, that every person, when they pass away and they come again to judgment, they have this whole movie that's shown for them. They see everything, you know, and it says above the door, no exit, not exit. And you belt it in, and the credits roll, produced by, written by, and your name is there, so you can't deny it. And you're asked questions, and everybody remembers everything that they did. They have to explain everything. You remember every single fine detail. There's one thing about which the sages say, invariably, nobody knows the answer to this question. You know what the question is? Anybody? The question is, what is your name? And the answer that the person gives, the sages say, is every person, with few exceptions, there are some exceptions, but most people say, Master of the universe, it is revealed before you that I do not know my name. And then there is in that Kabbalistic text a difficult passage of retribution that a soul goes through for not knowing his or her name. What is the message of that teaching? Is it on a simple level, well, a person goes through this life, does all kinds of great deeds, does all kinds of great things, and in the end we don't even know who we were? Is it that simple? There's an even deeper idea, which is that when you're asked a question, what is your name? The name that's being referred to is not your given name, not Tom, Harry. That's not it. The question that Hashem is asking is, what is the name of your own identity within that great comprehensive soul of Adam HaRishon, that for which I brought you to the world and which I gave you so many signals all throughout your life, gently urging you to know this is what I want you to do in this world, the thing that's difficult, the thing that you have to overcome. That's your tikkun. And unfortunately, most people apparently, invariably, spent their lives running away from that because it's a difficult thing to face up to. What is it that we're supposed to be doing in the world? And each one of us has a different contribution. So the bottom line of the experience for all of us as we are studying the book of Numbers, and again, this is us. That's the bottom line of Torah study. It's not information. It's not even inspiration. It's transformation. We're not studying Torah to amass knowledge. We're not studying Torah to be called scholars. We're studying Torah to change and to become the people that we could become. Not the people that we can't become, the people that we could have become. And so the beauty of this generation, to me, that is so difficult, that has such extremes, that is so conflicted, is that that's exactly how I feel. That's exactly who we are. We are so conflicted. But that's why Hashem gave them the Torah, and that's the power of the Torah. And that was their great crisis. And that was their terrible failing, that they misinterpreted what it means to be alive and on fire and living for Hashem. It's not to be in an ivory tower. It's not to separate ourselves. It's not to be living a life which is an imitation of holiness. It's to be living a life of true holiness, which is totally grounded in the very earth and stones of this world. And that was their one single failing, which cost them everything, their misinterpretation of what it means to be armed with the Torah, to be able to go into the land, to be able to do the tikkun, to embrace the Torah. And I think this is a mistake that is made in the name of religion so much by so many different people. The mystification of everything, as if this world around us is not good enough, but it was good enough for God when he said, make me an earth or stones altar. So we all are inspired by the deeper dimensions of Torah. We're all inspired to know the inner workings of how Hashem relates to his created universe. But the bottom line, again, of everything is Hashem's commandments, is studying to change, is to understand the beauty of this world and the reality of being a person and serving Hashem in this world. It's not far from us. It's right here. That's what Moshe says later. He says, it's not across the sea that someone has to go and get it for us, right? It's not in heaven. No one has to climb a ladder to get it. It's right here close to you, in your ear. And at Mount Sinai, when we were ready to receive the Torah, and I again assure you that every soul of every righteous person was at Mount Sinai, Hashem said to Israel, I'll give you the Torah, but what's your guarantee? What will be your guarantee? He wanted a guarantor. And they came up with different ideas, and finally, there was one suggestion that they made that Hashem accepted and said, okay, I'll give you the Torah. Our children will be our guarantor. And that's why Moshe later said, I'm not making this covenant and this imprecation only with those who are standing here today, but also with those who are not standing here today, the future generations. And that is our obligation, to make the Torah real, to bring it into this world. And one of the best ways that we can make it real and bring it into this world is by standing up for that which is the representation of the reality of Hashem in this world, which is the land of Israel. And so everything that we are going through now, all the reverberations, all of the terrible attempts to isolate and to vilify the state of Israel through BDS, through apartheid, through all of the things that are, all of the ridiculous lies that are said about the land of Israel, it all starts here. And I think that this is something that we can really do to contribute to the fabric of the Tikkun, is to stand up for the land of Israel and to realize that the Torah is real, and it's about a very, very real world, and it's about all of us in our own way, each according to our path, serving Hashem according to the special letter that we are in the Torah, the way that we learned it in the womb, to get back to Adam, to bring, as it were, the Torah into the land, all of us, and to sanctify Hashem's name in this world. And I know that each and every one of you are doing that, and I want to applaud, strengthen you, and tell you how precious your spiritual journey is to Hashem, and how I know it makes him so proud that from this place, if you had some sort of infrared kind of equipment that you could see things, you know, like on TV, there must be some kind of unbelievable light going up from here of people that are walking a path of bringing Hashem's light into the world. Thank you so much, and God bless you.